Before you hear my answer, you ought to consider how you would answer the question, how do adults acquire a second language? You can break that question into two separate but related parts. What do adults acquire, and how do they acquire it? Did vocabulary and grammar come to mind when thinking about the what? And if so, are you thinking of the word lists and rules in textbooks? How is that the same or different from the mental dictionary and mental grammar that linguists study? And when you thought about the how of acquisition, did you think of things like input, output, rules, practice, and correction? If so, try to be more specific. How do input, output, and the rest get turned into the what that ends up in our heads? So pause the video and jot down your answers. Press play when you're ready to go on. I preface my response by saying that I'm not committed to this being the answer, but I am persuaded. Because I read a lot about second language acquisition, SLA for short, I feel strongly that my perspective is on the right track, at least in line with a lot of current thinking about the topic. But it doesn't mean that I'm not open to changing my view. And nothing I say is an idea that originates with me. Really, I'm just summarizing one of the mainstream perspectives shared by many contemporary SLA researchers. Because I want to keep my answer to around 10 minutes, I can only be as specific as that time will allow. So, start the clock, and here we go. How do adults acquire a second language? At the heart of any answer is the following question. To what extent are the processes and mechanisms that underlie first language acquisition the same as those of second language acquisition? A lot of evidence and logic currently point more in the direction of same, but factors that play little to no role in the acquisition of a first language could, in some way, influence our ability to communicate in a second language. My answer is a dual systems theory, in which learners can draw on at least two different sources of knowledge to interpret and express messages. Since the beginning of the SLA field in the 1970s, there has existed a dual systems theory. Extra credit if you can name the model. And a version of this theory is still alive and well today, albeit refined, tweaked, elaborated, and dressed in contemporary terminology. There are multiple theories of SLA, but really some of these theories are not in competition, because they're not trying to describe development of the same type of knowledge. To construct a native type of knowledge, properties and mental capacities that we are born with act on the language that we try to comprehend. Another type of knowledge that is not made of the same stuff as native-like knowledge develops from textbook rules and practice. Despite the appeal of you can teach it however you want and get the same result, engaging different processes do not, in fact, result in the same product in our heads. Before I go any further, some key terms and the domain of SLA needs to be defined. The dominant view is that SLA is the study of internal mental states and their changes. Language refers to the internal language system, and the development or growth of that system is what is termed acquisition. Any good theory of SLA needs to be able to explain two principal observations, among others: the logical problem and the developmental problem. The logical problem asks how it is possible to know more than what learners have been exposed to. This is also known as the poverty of the stimulus. This includes knowing when sentences are wrong, even though we've never heard the sentences before and no one's ever told us that those sentences are wrong. To answer this problem requires a theory of language, the what of acquisition. That is what linguists study, and it only takes reading the first chapter of an introductory linguistics book to understand that what knowledge ends up in our head bears little to no resemblance to textbook rules. On the other hand, the developmental problem is to explain why learners follow universal stages of acquisition, that is, the how of acquisition. There are many different stages and orders that have been documented and that are not altered by instruction, which I think is the biggest secret kept from teachers. Accuracy doesn't develop on the teacher's schedule, and teachers get a glimpse of this whenever they ask their students to communicate spontaneously and freely about something they have not rehearsed. Input is the main, if not exclusive, ingredient that connects the how of acquisition to the what. Various definitions of input have been proposed. Sharwood Smith defined input as potentially processable language data. Van Patten and Wong defined it as communicatively oriented language that learners hear or see and attend to for meaning. There has been widespread agreement about the causal status of input since the beginning of the scientific study of SLA, but what is disputed are the details of how the input is used to construct the language system and how to characterize that system. Both the mainstream linguistic perspective, known as universal grammar, UG for short, as well as what is called a usage-based approach, they both depend on input for developing the language system. But whereas universal grammar posits that we are all born with constraints on language, and input is needed to choose which of those constraints are relevant to a given language, usage-based theories propose that we unconsciously count and associate pieces of language with each other based on the input we are exposed to. All this is not to say that output is not beneficial in other ways. For example, both perspectives would allow a potential role for output in improving access to and skill at knowledge that has already been acquired from input. Now, it sometimes appears that second language acquisition is harder than first language acquisition, and the outcomes are more variable than in first language acquisition. From this, it's tempting to conclude that first and second language acquisition are different. However, there are many internal as well as external factors that contribute to these differences, but that do not change the underlying process. To name just two factors, there are differences in the quantity and quality of input, and obviously, you did not already have another language in your head when you acquired a first language. Does it even make sense to expect a bilingual to obtain the same knowledge as that of a monolingual? After all, a bilingual is not just two monolinguals in one brain. And then there's another sort of SLA outcome that strongly supports the similarity of first and second language acquisition. That is, evidence of the logical problem. This is the lead motivator of universal grammar in first and second language acquisition. 20 years ago or so, the evidence reached what has been called a critical mass, because so many studies found the same thing. People have second language knowledge that could not have come from the first language, instruction, not analogy, nor even from the input. That is argued to only be possible if we are born with this knowledge and if adult second language learners still have access to it. I have time to give you one brief and simplified example. Imagine I'm talking about my family and you need to know that we're all short. If I said in English, "Nobody thinks that he is tall," then it can mean that not one person in my family thinks of himself or herself as being tall. You get the same interpretation if you say the sentence in Spanish but do not pronounce the pronoun for he, which is allowed in Spanish. But if I pronounce the pronoun in Spanish, then the interpretation changes and he refers to someone else other than a member of my family. English speakers learning Spanish at beginning, intermediate, and advanced levels know this, and the higher the level, the more native-like they are. But this subtle difference is something they could not have learned from their first language. It's not something they were ever taught, and they're never exposed to the sentence with the incorrect interpretation and get told it's wrong. This restriction on pronoun interpretation exists in all languages that allow pronouns not to be pronounced, such as Spanish and Chinese. Everyone is born with this restriction, so it's not something that needs to be learned, but it only becomes active in adult acquisition when the learner processes input from a language that does not pronounce pronouns. Extra credit if you know the name of this constraint. Each of the subsystems, sound, sentence structure, and meaning, are guided by their own constraints. But what about learning new word forms and their meanings? Here is where usage-based theories make sense. Words that often occur together, like good and morning, and that overlap in form, like right and fright, or are related in meaning, like apple and banana, are linked. All the links result in intricate webs, and the strength of the links is determined by the processing of input. Turning to the developmental problem, there is ample evidence that SLA is constrained and stage-like, much like first language acquisition. Children and adult second language learners, inside and outside of a classroom, all follow similar output orders and stages. Two main phenomena can conspire to create these stages: For one, there are limits on what learners can process in the input. In other words, they filter the input such that not all of it can be used to construct the acquired system in their heads. And two, there are limits on what learners can produce in real time. Learners develop the ability to match up grammatical information within the same phrase, as in the noun phrase, two kids, before they can match up information between phrases, as in subject-verb agreement. In fact, according to the proposed hierarchy, subject-verb agreement is stage 5 of 6 total stages, and these stages cannot be skipped. I will now briefly discuss the other potential source of knowledge, information we have about language, that is, learning grammar, also called metalinguistic knowledge. There are two main and competing theories of grammar learning, skill acquisition theory and socioculturalism. In skill building, learners try to learn a rule that they then practice until its use becomes faster and faster. In socioculturalism, the rule is learned first with the help of visuals and other materials, then with the support of others, until it is internalized. Because these theories do not intend to explain the logical and developmental problems, and because the process and product is qualitatively different from what was discussed prior, I consider these fringe theories of SLA, or even to fall outside of the domain of SLA. It is up to research to determine the limits of metalinguistic ability. Sometimes you come across comments that explicit instruction, where that means rule-based instruction, is better than an approach that doesn't teach textbook rules. But there are many buts to that statement, not the least of which is the fact that most of these studies measure language gains with controlled tests and only measure gains in the short term. Even one lead advocate of skill building acknowledges that the theory best accounts for what happens in high aptitude, adult, beginner learners of easy to explain rules in a classroom. I would also like to point out that this theory would not support some common grammar teaching practices that spend too much time on exercises that don't require attention to meaning and try to cover too much. And neither skill theory nor socioculturalism denies that what happens in the minds of learners in non-grammar-based learning contexts is qualitatively different. Sometimes the native and the non-native systems are said to compete, such that instruction tailored to one system can interfere with learning by the other system. For instance, a brain study found that learners getting only about 10 minutes of grammar teaching resulted in learners not having native-like brain responses, even after they had the same 3.5 hours of practice as the group that was not taught grammar, and that did show native-like brain patterns. In summary, on the one hand, we have an internal system that is qualitatively the same as the first language, in that both consist of constraints and word webs that internal mechanisms construct from interpreting input. That process we call acquisition. Choosing constraints and forming word webs all happen outside of our awareness. The only thing we are ever directly conscious of are the sounds and appearance of written words. And we can use conscious problem solving to figure out the meaning of the language we hear or read. On the other hand, there is conscious knowledge of textbook rules that we can internalize through practice and which may help us communicate under some conditions. But there are limitations on the learning of this information and use of this knowledge, and it may interfere with acquisition. Whereas 40 years ago, the distinction between two different processes and knowledge sources, that is, acquisition versus learning, was largely a metaphor, today, more of the details have been sketched out and will continue to be filled in by future research.